17 and are still taking items. You may bring items to the church any day, and we are sorting in the fellowship hall, the nursery school area. If you would like to help sort and price items or need something picked up, please contact Margaret Fisher for the church office. All monies raised will go to support our local mission projects.
I just want to come and tell you a little bit about Grace and my, Grace Manning and I went on a little field tour yesterday that we're trying to figure out what to do with items that are left over from our yard sale. And we went down to YIPAC, which is a place that they take donations and they give donations. It's a mission outreach. But in the meantime, we found another part of their building is being used by Bella's Closet. And we had the most wonderful visit there at Bella's Closet, and they are an outreach service also. And all the women's clothing that we have will go to Bella's Closet afterwards, and they also give it away. There was a lady that was there yesterday that went shopping and she wanted church clothes. And I need to tell you, they have it set up so nice, as does YIPAC, and they're all mission driven. So, the reason I wanted to be up here is all women in the church, I want to invite you on Tuesday, June the 13th, which is our day circle, United Women in Faith. We will have a visitor here that day who is in charge of Bella's Closet and wants to explain how they came about, how God called them to be a mission project, and it's Cindy Pitts, Joe Pitts' wife. And if you've never been to Bella's Closet, I'd like to invite you to come on Tuesday at 10:30. We will be here in the sanctuary so everybody can hear the story of Bella's Closet, because it is something that we stand for as United Women in Faith and helping people that need help. And I think that this is, I just want to invite everybody that's in this church, everyone, and if you have friends that you would like to bring with you, please bring them, because if they have, it's an amazing story, and Grace and I had just a wonderful afternoon over there. We didn't get a chance really to talk to the IPAC people, but they also take donations for the gift. So what we have left over clothes-wise, you can bring them here. You can bring them that day if you don't want them in our yard sale. We have clothes that we're going to go ahead and have them here, but they will all go, all the women's clothes will go to Bella's Closet, and then the men's and the children's preschool and so forth will go through YIPAC. And it's over on Paradise Hill Road. And I just would like to invite you to come to hear Cindy Pitts and the story about Bella's Closet. Thank you. 10:30 on Tuesday the 13th.
June 18th to the 21st will be the Tennessee and Western Kentucky United Methodist Annual Conference in Memphis, Tennessee. Please be in prayer for our clergy and lay delegates and those that will be traveling. If you don't receive an email newsletter, you can pick up a newsletter in the narthex. And as always, please fill out the attendance pad at the end of your pew to let us know if you will listen to worship.
Good morning.
It is a joy
to worship with all of you this morning. Whether this is your first time or you have been attending for years, whether you are strong in your faith or you still have some questions, no matter your age, your tax bracket, your ability, or the color of your skin, no matter who you love or who loves you, you are welcome here. I invite you to join me in our call to worship. We like the 11 on the mountainside have doubts. We come to encounter God, who is both immense and particular, greater than words can describe, and yet intimately present with us.
Holy Trinity, surround us with your love that brings order to chaos and community to individuals.
We give thanks. We come to give thanks to the God who created and sustains us, and who calls us to steward the earth and all that live in it.
Holy Trinity, empower us to continue your partnership with you, with the privilege of all ages, with gratitude and joy.
We come to receive Christ's commission to make disciples, to baptize, and to teach the gospel wherever we go.
Thank you.
don't know what we have done to deserve your love, God. Maybe nothing at all. And yet, you give it freely, openly, enthusiastically, asking only that we receive it, hoping only that we share it. Come and help us receive it. Come and help us share it. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is Genesis 1:1 through 2:4. It will be visual liturgy, and so I invite you to turn your attention to the screen as we hear the story of creation.
In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while wind from God swept over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness God called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome, and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome the sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together God called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on the earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser lights of the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created the humanity, the God, in God's image. In the image of God, God created him, it, male and female, God created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, and everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that God had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that God had done. And God rested on the seventh day from all the work that God had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that God had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created.
Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 28. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." The words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Whoever desires to be saved should above all hold the universal faith. Anyone who does not keep it whole and unbroken will doubtless perish eternally. Now this is the universal faith, that we worship one God in Trinity and the Trinity in unity, neither blending their persons nor dividing their essence. For the person of the Father is a distinct person. The person of the Son is another, and that of the Holy Spirit is still another. But the divinity of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is one, their glory equal, their majesty co-eternal. What quality the Father has, the Son has, and the Holy Spirit has. The Father is uncreated, the Son is uncreated, the Holy Spirit is uncreated. The Father is immeasurable. The Son is immeasurable. The Holy Spirit is immeasurable. The Father is eternal. The Son is eternal. The Holy Spirit is eternal. And yet, there are not three eternal beings. There is but one eternal being. So two that are not three uncreated or immeasurable beings, there is but one uncreated and immeasurable being. Similarly, the Father is almighty, the Son is almighty, the Holy Spirit is almighty. Yet there are not three almighty beings, there is but one almighty being. Thus, the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. Yet, there are not three gods. There is but one God. Thus, the Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, the Holy Spirit is Lord. Yet, there are not three Lords. There is but one Lord. Just as Christian truth compels us to confess each person individually as both God and Lord, so universal religion forbids us to say that there are three gods or lords. The Father was neither made nor created nor begotten from anyone. The Son was neither made nor created. He was begotten from the Father alone. The Holy Spirit was neither created nor begotten. He proceeds from the Father and the Son. Accordingly, there is one Father, not three fathers. There is one Son, not three sons. There is one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits. Nothing in this Trinity is before or after. Nothing is greater or smaller. In their entirety, the three persons are co-eternal and co-equal with each other. So in everything, as we said earlier, we must worship their Trinity in their unity, and their unity in their Trinity. Anyone, then, who desires to be saved should think thus about the Trinity. But it is necessary for eternal salvation that one also believe in the incarnation of the Lord Jesus Christ faithfully. Now this is the true faith, that we believe and confess that our Lord is Jesus Christ, God's Son, is both God and human equally. He is God from the essence of the Father, begotten before time, and he is human from the essence of his mother, born in time. Completely God, completely human, with a rational soul and a human flesh, equal to the Father as regards divinity, less than the Father as regards humanity. Although he is God and human, yet Christ is not two, but one. He is, however, not by his divinity being turned into flesh, but by God's taking humanity to himself. He is one, certainly not by the blending of his essence, but by the unity of his person. For just as one human is both rational soul and flesh, so too the one Christ is both God and human. He suffered for our salvation. He descended to hell. He arose from the dead. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the Father's right hand. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. At his coming, all people will arise bodily and give an accounting of their own deeds. Those who have done good will enter eternal life, and those who have done evil will enter eternal fire. This is the universal faith. One cannot be saved without believing it firmly and faithfully. I didn't write those words. That was the creed of Athanasius, so it is misattributed to him. But it outlines the relationship between the Trinity. Aren't you glad we said the Apostles' Creed this morning? And I really do hope that by hearing the 660-word creed, all your questions about the Trinity have been answered. You have no more questions about the nature of the Trinity, which is, of course, the purpose of Trinity Sunday, is to answer all of our questions. I can say, with some degree of confidence, that we don't necessarily fully understand the Trinity just because I read that at you for 5 minutes. We can say, though, that we appreciate the language of this creed, and that we appreciate the desire to find a deeper understanding of who God is. At the risk of overusing one of my favorite illustrations, I want to tell you about Dr. Anthony Brickman and one of my first days of seminary. Dr. Brickman was my church history professor, and on those first days of seminary, where I was so overwhelmed, just a mere week after I had called my father from the quad in tears, telling him, "I've made a horrible mistake. I'm in way above my head." Dr. Brickman begins explaining Trinitarian theology and how it has evolved throughout church history. He began telling us all of the different illustrations, all of the different examples used to explain the Trinity. The Trinity is like different states of water, solid, liquid, and gas. The Trinity is like an egg with the shell and the egg white and the yolk. The Trinity is like an apple with the flesh and the fruit and the seed. The Trinity is like a shamrock with its three leaves connected at the stem. So Dr. Brickman goes on and on with these examples. And then he goes on and on to tell us why each of these examples is actually heresy. I won't get into all of the different types of heresy they are, If you would like that information, please come see me in my office. While he moved us away from the heresy, he didn't just leave us stranded in, well, cool. Instead, he moved us to hope that we weren't all doomed to be heretics for the rest of our lives. He left us with a sentence that I think about almost every day. He said, "We can know God truly, but not fully." What we truly know about God is that God created each of us in God's own image. What we truly know about God is that God sent God's only Son. What we truly know about God is that God poured the Holy Spirit upon us. What we truly know about God is that God has called us to share what we truly know about who God is. What we truly know about God is that God stands with the oppressed and the marginalized and the overlooked. What we truly know about God is that God hears our prayers. What we truly know about God is that God faces challenges with us. What we truly know about God is that God cries with us. God laments with us. What we truly know is that God forgives our sins. What we truly know is that God rejoices with us and in us. What we truly know about God is that God is with us as we live into the mystery of faith. What we truly know about God is that God has called us beloved. We could go on and on and on and on about what we truly know about who God is. And there is commonality in who God is to each of us. And there are moments where we say, "This is who God is to me," which might be different from who God is to you. And the beauty in truly knowing God is that we cannot fully know God, which means that everything we know is true. And God is so far beyond, is so much more than what we can ever imagine. So what do we do with that truth? Well, as children of God, as followers of Christ, we have been called and we have been sent. We have been called and sent to share the love of Christ. We have been sent to proclaim the love of Christ. We have been sent to embody the love of Christ so that it emanates from us and cannot be contained. We have been sent knowing that Christ is with us every step of the way. So on this Trinity Sunday, I think it's okay that we don't have all the answers. In fact, I think it is excellent that we don't have all the answers. Because without all of the answers, we are unleashed to err on the side of love. We are unleashed to err on the side of compassion. We are unleashed to err on the side of Christ. Because each of us was made in God's own image At this time, I invite our ushers forward for this morning's offering. God, pour out your spirit upon these, our gifts. Gifts that have been graciously given to us, that we now humbly return to you. May they be used to show your kingdom on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Are there any others?
We're going to be in church today.
It is a joy to have Randy back in church with us today after too long of an absence. So we rejoice that he is back with us this morning. Let us go to God in prayer. Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for this community, for this gathering of people who have come to ask questions and be okay with your answers. Oh God, we lift up to you all of the prayers of our hearts, prayers for our world, prayers for justice and hope and peace, prayers for our nation, for unity, for that same justice and peace we pray for our world. Oh God, we pray for this community as it faces loss and grief, as we pray for healing and wholeness, as we rejoice for the people who are in our midst. Oh God, be with us. Hear the deepest prayers of our hearts. Help us live into the call you have placed on each of our lives to be your disciples. Oh God, we have been created in your image, and we have been called your beloved. As we come to our time of Holy Communion, we are reminded that this is not my table. This is not your table. This is not St. Bethlehem's table. This is not the United Methodist Church's table. This is Christ's table. And you are welcome here. This morning, you'll be invited to come forward to receive communion. Our usher will direct you, and you're invited to kneel at the altar, and our server will bring you the piece of bread and a cup. You're invited to stay and pray, and I will dismiss each group with a blessing. Any money that is left on the altar goes to our Helping Hands Fund, which goes to assist our neighbors in need. Christ, our Lord, invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the need. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thank you. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for the day when justice shall roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they war. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Son anointed him to, your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim the release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and reign at your right hand. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you do this, do so in remembrance of me." When supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. May them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Because there is one loaf, we who are many partake in the one loaf. The bread which we break is sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is sharing in the blood of Christ. At this time, I invite those assisting with communion to come forward. Thank you. of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we come to the close of our service this morning, I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing together hymn number 584, Lord, We Give the Great Commission.
Thank you.